Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be freed, and the life of the world may move forward into broad, sunlit uplands. But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duty, and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its commonwealths last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour. A Nazi invasion of Great Britain last autumn would have been a more or less improvised affair. Hitler took it for granted that when France gave in, we should give in. But we did not give in, and he had to think again. An invasion now will be supported by a much more carefully prepared tackle and equipment of landing craft and other apparatus, all of which will have been planned and manufactured during the winter months. We must all be prepared to meet gas attacks, parachute attacks, and glider attacks with constancy, forethought, and practiced skill. In order to win the war, Hitler must destroy Great Britain. With every month that passes, the many proud and once happy countries he is now holding down by brute force and vile intrigue, are learning to hate the Prussian yoke and the Nazi name as nothing has ever been hated so fiercely and so widely among men before. And all the time, masters of the sea and air, the British Empire, nay, in a certain sense, the whole English-speaking world, will be on his track, bearing with them the swords of justice. The other day, President Roosevelt gave his opponent in the late presidential election a letter of introduction to me. And in it he wrote out a verse in his own handwriting from Longfellow, which he said applies to you people as it does to us. Here is the verse. Sail on, O ship of state. Sail on, O Union, strong and great. Humanity, with all its fears, with all the hopes of future years, is hanging breathless on thy fate. What is the answer that I shall give in your name to this great man, the thrice chosen head of a nation of 130 millions? Here is the answer which I will give to President Roosevelt. Put your confidence in us. Give us your faith and your blessing. And under Providence, all will be well. We shall not fail or falter. We shall not weaken or tire. Neither the sudden shock of battle nor the long-drawn trials of vigilance and exertion will wear us down. Give us the tools, and we will finish the job.
And once again, we have been forced into war. I know that you would wish me to voice, in the name of the women of the British Empire, our deep and abiding sympathy with those on whom the first cruel and shattering blows have fallen, the women of Poland. Nor do we forget the gallant womanhood of France, who are called on to share with us again the hardships and sorrows of war. War has at all times called for the fortitude of women. Even in other days, when it was an affair of the fighting forces only, wives and mothers at home suffered constant anxiety for their dear ones, and too often the misery of bereavement. Their lot was all the harder because they felt that they could do so little beyond heartening through their own courage and devotion the men at the front. Now this is all changed, for we, no less than men, have real and vital work to do. To us also is given the proud privilege of serving our country in her hour of need. The call has come, and from my heart I thank you, the women of our great empire, for the way that you have answered it. The tasks that you have undertaken, whether at home or in distant lands, cover every field of national service. And I would like to pay my tribute to all of you who are giving such splendid and unselfish help in this time of trouble. At the same time, I do not forget the humbler part which so many of you have to play in these trying times. I know that it is not so difficult to do the big things. The novelty, the excitement of new and interesting duties have an exhilaration of their own. But these tasks are not for every woman. It is the thousand and one worries and irritations in carrying on wartime life in ordinary homes which are often so hard to bear. Many of you have had to see your family life broken up, your husband going off to his allotted task, your children evacuated to places of greater safety. The King and I know what it means to be parted from our children, and we can sympathize with those of you who have bravely consented to this separation for the sake of your little ones. Equally, do we appreciate the hospitality shown by those of you who have opened your homes to strangers and to children sent from places of special danger. All this, I know, has meant sacrifice. And I would say to those who are feeling the strain, be assured that in carrying on your home duties and meeting all these worries cheerfully, you are giving real service to the country. You are taking your part in keeping the home front, which will have dangers of its own, stable and strong. It is, after all, for our homes and for their security that we are fighting. And we must see to it that, despite all the difficulty of these days, our homes do not lose those very qualities which make them the background as well as the joy of our lives. Women of all lands yearn for the day when it will be possible to set about building a new and better world where peace and goodwill shall abide. That day must come. Meantime, to all of you in every corner of the empire who are doing such fine work in all our services, or who are carrying on at home amidst the trials of these days, I would give a message of hope and encouragement. We have all a part to play, and I know you will not fail in yours. Remembering always that the greater your courage and devotion, the sooner shall we see again in our midst the happy, ordered life for which we long. Only when we have won through to an enduring peace shall we be free to work unhindered for the greater happiness and well-being of all mankind. We put our trust in God, who is our refuge and strength in all times of trouble. I pray with all my heart that he may bless and guide and keep you always.
I am speaking to you from the Cabinet Room at 10 Downing Street. This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently this country is at war with Germany. You can imagine what a bitter blow it is to me that all my long struggle to win peace has failed. Yet I cannot believe that there is anything more or anything different that I could have done and that would have been more successful. Up to the very last, it would have been quite possible to have arranged a peaceful and honorable settlement between Germany and Poland. But Hitler would not have it. He had evidently made up his mind to attack Poland whatever happened. And although he now says he put forward reasonable proposals which were rejected by the Poles, that is not a true statement. The proposals were never shown to the Poles, nor to us. And though they were announced in the German broadcast on Thursday night, Hitler did not wait to hear comments on them, but ordered his troops to cross the Polish frontier the next morning. His action shows convincingly that there is no chance of expecting that this man will ever give up his practice of using force to gain his will. He can only be stopped by force. And we and France are today, in fulfillment of our obligations, going to the aid of Poland, who is so bravely resisting this wicked and unprovoked attack upon her people. We have a clear conscience. We have done all that any country could do to establish peace. But a situation in which no word given by Germany's ruler could be trusted, and no people or country could feel itself safe, had become intolerable. And now that we have resolved to finish it, I know that you will all play your part with calmness and courage.
Thank you. Thank you.